Roscoe's back. Welcome back to Sunday Morning Quickies, episode 42 for the 15th of May, 2022. You are a purr pot. This week, we're going to continue the serialization of this 1591 that belongs to the thrift shop of the New Jersey Blind Citizens Association. This is the machine, as if you'll recall, that I'm donating the overhaul to. Anyway, this week, what we're going to do is we're doing the bottom end of that machine. We're taking everything off on the whole feed mechanism, as well as the hook driving mechanism and everything. We're going to clean that. Get it all ready to rock and roll, put it back together again. We're also going to take the stitch length regulator mechanism apart, clean that, and put it back in. What we're not going to do is we're not going to take the connecting rod out of this machine. What I discovered during the disassembly was that one of the screws just didn't want to cooperate. And sometimes discretion is the better part of valor. So rather than take a chance of damaging the screw, or worse yet, damaging the connecting rod, I left that in place, cleaned it in place. The journal does move fine on the big end, I should say, does move fine on its journal in the main shaft going through. Cleaned and lubricated, we're going to leave it alone. Because the last thing I want to do is bust a connecting rod on a 70-year-old machine that doesn't belong to me, and then go have to look to find parts. I want to get this machine back and in their thrift shop so they can make some money with it. Anyway, kick back, grab a cup of coffee, let's do it. All right, I'm going to start today on working on this 15-91. I've already done the motor and the light unit for this machine. What I'm going to start on today is I'm going to start at the bottom. I'm going to work on the bottom end of this machine first, get this apart, get it clean, and then I'm going to worry about stuff up top. So I'm going to start off on this end. I'm just going to take off the two screws that hold the hook race. I should say, technically it's a shuttle race. And just pull that whole shooting match straight off. This machine is quite filthy, as you can see. So I figure I'll just tackle it a little bit at a time, and we'll get through this. This is being done for charity, so. And as you can see, that's pretty grungy. Not as bad as some I've seen, but it is pretty grungy. Actually, it is as bad. Because looky here, what's inside. Watch what comes out as I capture. I'll set it down here. I'll take a quick look. You can see there's a lot of lint coming out of this. No dead mice, just a lot of lint. So quite a bit of grunge, no biggie. Now this one's a little different than most of the 15s. On this one, bigger screwdriver than that. It doesn't have the 9/16 nuts, and it's got a different style of pivots here. So we're gonna have to get in here and take this apart a little differently. Actually, I'm gonna have to disconnect connecting rod before I do too much further. And I don't have a balance wheel on, so I'm going to just jam a paintbrush handle in there. There we go. And that'll break that free. And And you can see this particular screw. This has got the tapered head. It actually threads into this rod. And the nut is just a jam nut. Like every other 15 we've looked at. Now, I'm going to use my Craftsman ratcheting screwdriver with a wide bit. Put that in here. Get a little bit of extra leverage. Come on. Okay, that's not wanting to give it up, so we'll put a little aerocroil on them. We'll let that sit for a second. And we'll come back to them. There we go. This is a case where the Chapman is actually a little easier. There we go. Loosens that up. He's back way out. Okay, there we go. Just a little bit of pressure. And they move. And we can then grab with a pair of pliers and they will come out. They're just held in place with 60 or 70 years worth of shmoo. The Japanese-made 15 clones actually use this style quite often. It's the style of pivot point. And they were quite successful with it. Getting this out is going to be a challenge. Just got to get it past. All right, I'm just going to spin that around and break that free a little bit. And then push it back. A little bit of lubrication on there. Because actually, you can see these don't actually screw, they just push. There it goes. That got the shmoo out. And here it comes. And that one's freed up. All right, I am going to take the lifting rock shaft out. And that does need the 9/16. Loosen it up on both ends. Out. And those are fully retracted now. And there we go. Out comes all this good crud. Now you'll see there's a actual oil wick inside here. Right in there is a felt oil wick. We will be replacing that. Okay. I'm going to tap that from the back side. And that is the correct side. And we will just give this a little tappy tap tap. The pin drops out. Here is the pin. And now I'm going to have to loosen these set screws. Loosen those up, actually. I'm going to remove that. Is that the only one on there? It's the only one there. Very good. And now I'm going to take another punch, put it here. And give it a little tappy tap tap, and that's going to knock the bottom shaft out. Okay,
And just for safekeeping, I'm going to put this set screw back in here. Because God knows I can lose stuff with the best of them. All right. So now we're able to withdraw the bottom shaft with the hook driver. You can see how filthy that is. Now, we will pull out, we'll take off first the linkage to the fork. Move the fork linkage. There we go. Loosen that up. Get that nut. Now this is going to be the eccentric bolt. And we'll come over here. Actually, this should just pop right out, and it does. And once again, we will put the nut on the eccentric bolt so we don't lose it. We're all about not losing things today. And then once again, we will grab our 9/16 inch wrench. We'll come over, loosen these pivot points. Pull out the feed dog rock shaft once we back out a pivot point all the way. And out comes the feed dog rock shaft. And oh, look at all that crap and all the crap here. This has all got to be cleaned. All right, we will take that apart eventually. Clean all that. Get a brush in here. Okay, I'm going to leave the pivot points in place for the moment. We will eventually replace those, or I should say clean those. Next thing we're going to do, I'm going to stand her back up, and I'm going to take off the numbered plate here for the stitch length regulator. Now this is missing a screw. I believe I have one of those in my spare parts. I hope I do. If not, I will go online and I will find one. And we'll take that off, take the inner plate off, set that aside. You can see how nasty the entire stitch length adjusting mechanism is. It's pretty gross in there. I lost power there for a second. I lost camera battery. I lost a little bit of footage. I did take out the stitch length regulator mechanism, which as you can see is all gummed up. That bearing does not want to come off of there. That's going to have to soak off in some aerocryl. There's the lever and the appropriate screw. I'm going to leave the connecting rod in this machine. I discovered that while one screw was perfectly willing to come out, the other screw, the head, appears to be damaged. It looked like somebody was in there, didn't know what they were doing at some point in this poor machine's life. So rather than screw it up further, I'm going to leave it in place. It seems to pivot nicely on the main shaft, so I'm not going to worry about it. I will reach in through holes and try to get some of the schmoo off of it. But I'm not going to take that apart, at least not at this juncture. This machine has its fair share of issues, difficulties, difficulties, as I like to say. So I'm going to worry about the stuff that I am absolutely 100% sure I can resolve completely, rather than take unnecessary chances disassembling portions of this machine, which, if I can't get it, I risk damaging it further. And, you know, the old saying, you know, at first do no harm. Well, that, in addition to medicine, that carries through on sewing machines as well. All right, so I got the underside of this machine denudered as far as it's going to go. We're going to clean this up. I'll take the needle plate off, obviously. But we're going to do some cleaning on this. We'll do some polishing and cleaning of components. And we're going to get the bottom end back together before we do the top end. I'm going to spare you the approximately 2.5 hours that I spent doing nothing but cleaning bottom end parts on this machine. I took all of the rock shafts and the shaft for the shuttle driver to the bench grinder with the wire wheel, and I got all the nastiness off that. Then I spent an inordinate amount of time at the bench with rotary tools and wire brushes and the Scotch-Brite pads and you name it, just cleaning and polishing. It was an inordinate amount of time involved in that. So I'm going to spare you all of that, with the exception of what you're seeing go by right now. And just suffice it to say that when we do the needle bar box area, there's going to be also a lot of time that's going to get involved in cleaning and polishing. And if you really want to see that, I've got other videos that are posted where you can see all that kind of good, gross, schmooey stuff. But I'll spare you on this one because we're already like 16 and a half minutes into this.
Just working on cleaning some of the dirt off of this machine. And I exposed the badge. And hey, she's a centennial. I hadn't noticed that. I knew she was from, her serial number put her around 1950, but I didn't know she had a centennial badge on her. So that's pretty cool. Not that it changes anything. It's just pretty cool. You see, she's got a lot of pin rash here. This old girl did a lot of work in her life. So she's deserving of a good bath. The shellac is not in great shape by any stretch of the imagination. So I'm not going to compound her, because I'll just wind up taking off decals if I do that. I'm just wiping her down with sewing machine oil. And right now she's just getting a cursory wipe down so I can start the reassembly. This is just to get most of the dirt off of her exterior. Fortunately, sewing machine oil will help pull dirt off. But I'm not going to do anything with shellac on her at all. At this stage of the game, and with the damage to her shellac as it is, I think that would be a losing proposition. Right now, the original mission, was just make her safe so she could be sold. Now the mission is a little different. Still make her safe to be sold, but it's make her so that I can tell whoever buys it that if they have a problem with it, I'll warranty the work. And you heard that right. I'm warranting something that I am not directly selling. I may live to regret it, but I'll have the serial number for this machine in my book as to where it went. So that should keep everybody honest. To start the reassembly of the bottom back together, believe it or not, the first thing we're going to do is we're going to put the needle plate in. Now, I already chased these holes with an 840 tap. That's a number 8 40 thread per inch tap, because these were a little grungy when I was taking it apart. They were a little sticky. I haven't cleaned the needle plate yet, nor have I polished the screw heads. This is only going on temporarily, but it is necessary for the first portion of the reassembly to
get this back on, because what we're going to be doing is we're going to be putting in the feed dog rock shaft first thing, and that's going to require making some adjustments, which we're going to do with a needle plate installed. The adjustments that are going to be made is the lateral adjustment of the feed dog as it comes up through the opening in the needle plate. So we need the needle plate on here. And before we do anything else on the bottom of the machine, we really need to have the that feed dog rock shaft in place. Now, I've reattached the feed dog to the arm. I'm going to put a little bit of lubrication on this, but this is pretty much ready to go. You see why this has to go in first. That's why it was the last thing out. And it definitely has to go in before the center shaft does. So let's get a pivot point started. We won't bother with the nuts, the lock nuts just yet. We're just going to get the pivot points going where they need to be. So we have a pivot point there. We have a pivot screw going in on this side. Okay. We're just doing that finger tight. And what I want to do is I'm going to shine a light from behind, and I'm going to look through and see if I've got... Actually, I'm going to shine it facing away from me. And here, let me turn this so you can see. Notice, I don't know how well you can see, I got this pretty well evened out. The space on either side here, and I might have to turn this a little bit more for you. I'll shine light back here. You can see the space is reasonably even. I got to tighten up, get some of the slop out of this, but that's nice and evened up now. So I'm just going to, with that even, I'm going to take a screwdriver and just move that a little bit more. That looks good. That's too tight. That's too tight. There we go. And that's good. That's nice and even. Now, what we do from there, I'm going to put a lock screw on. I'm not moving the screw just yet. Just going to snug that up with my fingers. This side, do the same thing. Just snug it up with my, put it on, get it snug with my fingers. Double checking, and that still feels good. We're still good there. Now, I'm going to grab a 9/16 inch wrench. In this case, I have to put it around my screwdriver because this is a box. And then hold it with the screwdriver in the slot of the screw, the pivot screw. I'm going to hold that in place. And just give a little bit of pressure. Just tighten that up. That didn't go too tight. Very good. And lather, rinse, repeat on this side. Doing the same thing with the 9/16. And once again, I am not a lefty, so this is going to be, this is always so much fun doing it so you can see, because I'm not a lefty. And let me feel what that slop feels like. Nope, I thought I'd move that screwdriver a little bit. There we go. Screwdriver's good. All right. Contact, back off just a touch. There we go. Now, what do we have happening down here now? Perfect. Okay. Next thing we're going to put in is the center shaft and the crank arm. Get that on, and we'll take our tapered pin put it in the hole, and just give it a little tapiology here. Not hitting it too hard. I'm going to bring it so it's just under the edge there. And it's just one more tap. Perfect. I'm going to leave it like that. Now, when we put the oscillating shaft in, you'll notice I've already polished all these surfaces here. But this block on the center shaft, I want this hole, because that's an oil point. I want that so it's facing out. So I'm going to rotate that around. I'm going to slide this on and then make sure this connecting rod is up. Bring this over. Now, notice that there's a flat on this pin, making the flat point kind of towards me here. It's okay. It's going to move a little bit, but the screw will find the flat and will point it. Likewise, I'm going to do that. And now, I'm holding a little pressure here, not much, but what I'm going to do, let me make this so you can see it. You can see where that bearing block is on that pivot point. I'm going to center that block with this arm, and I'm just using light pressure, basically just holding it in place. I don't want a lot of friction here. Just going to do that, and I'm going to tighten these set screws. I can feel this catching the flat and rotating it slightly. It's really a good design. I'm going to do the same with this one. I can feel that move a little bit. Now we have great motion and we're centered up. Easy peasy. One improvement Singer made, I don't know at what point they did it, they engraved a little groove going around and they put a snap ring into that groove, which helps you position this device here. This device serves two purposes. It allows you to drop the feed dogs, and it also is dropping the feed dogs from this screw. That's what the feed dog operates, the feed dog drop, and this screw here is how we adjust the feed dog height. So this has to go in so that this fork is riding on this cam, and this bearing surface here, which I want to get a little bit more lubrication into that, to be honest. Free that up, just make sure that stays free. That goes into this fork off the feed dog arm. So, what I'm going to do first, I'm going to back out the pivot points a little bit. I had taken these out, I already cleaned them and polished them. I put them back in. And now I'm just going to get that up and in position. Now I'm going to run the one side of the pivot in. Actually, I'm going to get a little bit of oil on that. There we go. And then run the other side in a little bit. And we have a goal here, and I'll explain that goal in a moment. Let me just get this properly in the proper orientation. There we go. Now, okay. Now I'm pressing the lifter arm back towards this pivot screw. What I'm aiming to do here, actually, I'm going to loosen up the positioning arm here. What I'm going to do is I'm going to adjust this pivot screw in so that this arm, these arms coming off, center on the cam that this is riding on. Just like that. Centered on the cam. Now I'm going to come back to the opposite end. I'm going to get the pivot screw in. Loosen the lock nut a little bit. Pivot screw in so that there's no lateral play but free movement. I've actually got that a little tight right at the moment. There's lateral play, lateral play. Lateral play is gone. And do we have free movement? Yes, we do. Okay, we're going to lather, rinse, repeat on what we did before. I'm going to slip the wrench over my screwdriver, get the screwdriver in the slot, hold the screwdriver firmly in position, and then tighten up that nut. Once again, this is a 9/16 inch wrench. Okay. That still feels good. All right. Now, I'm just going to move the nut manually here, get it roughly in position. Get the screwdriver through my wrench in the hole, or should I say in the slot of the screw, and just tighten her up. Doesn't have to crank. All right. Now, probably wondering, all right, Bob, what's going on with this? Well, the nice thing about that snap ring is it positions the bearing properly in the arm. So what we're going to do, next step, is, well, we're going to get the connecting rods on. I'm going to get the linkage for the connecting rod reconnected, I should say. Here we go. Got to turn that so it's relatively in the right position. Okay, now I'm going to get a little bit of oil on my nice polished surface here. I'm going to get the screw started. Now this screw is actually screwing into, it's threaded into this oscillating shaft. So we don't want to make it too tight. It's entirely possible to make that way too tight. So I'm going to back that off so it's got a little bit of slack. And I'm going to take and get a nut on there, and that takes a 7/16 inch wrench, and there we go. And looky here, we've got the bottom of the machine back together again. We don't have the feed dogs. We don't have the feed dogs adjusted yet. What I'm going to do next is I'm going to put the stitch length regulator mechanism back in place. Okay, we're going to put the stitch length regulator back in. What I'm going to do first is I'm going to take the arm with its bearing block. I'm going to insert it into the machine, get it up on the cam, and put the small end, the pivoting end, down here. Just lay it in position and just drop on the eccentric screw. Next, I'm going to reach through in here and take the bearing surface, and everything has already been pre-lubricated. I'm going to slide that block into its appropriate spot, then looking down the top, line up the hole in the block, in the pivoting block, with the hole in the casting, put the mounting screw in, tighten the mounting screw, and then I'll go ahead and I'll just loosely fit the nut on the bottom of the eccentric screw. I'm not going to do the adjustment on this just yet. There's more things I want to clean. I'll do that as part of the final adjustment. What this does is this adjusts the fore and aft position of the feed dog in the needle plate. I'm just going to leave it as it is for the moment. Well, now the bottom of the machine is done, and we still have a little bit of cleaning to do up top. We're going to get some more grunge off of this. And of course, we're going to take everything out of the needle bar box and clean that, but that's going to be for the next episode. So that's as far as we're going to go on this machine for today.
So, Roscoe, did that bore you? You really don't care as long as you've got a lap or somebody to hold you.
I know. Anyway, that's what I've got for you this week. Thank you so much for watching, and we'll see you on the next one.
Yeah, you're such a good boy. Yes, you are.